To all IEM and UEM family members again, I'm sure I'm audible and visible. So today you can see alongside me Dr. Umesh Kumar Das, and his topic, he's in the Department of Civil Engineering, and most probably his masters are also in Water Resources Engineering, if I'm not wrong. So he Yes. is actually introducing that topic only today, Water Resources Engineering. It is very interesting. I have heard one or two lectures prior to this on water resources engineering. So I will also be waiting for your lecture. So you can take over from here, Dr. Umesh. Okay, we are
okay, thank you, sir.
Waiting for that. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, so good afternoon to all IEM and UEM family members. So today's topic of discussion is introduction to water resources engineering. So let me introduce you first to a term called hydrology. It simply means science of water, and it deals with the occurrence, circulation and distribution of water of the earth and also the earth's atmosphere. We need to always remember that this particular branch of engineering, hydrology, not only deals with the water of the earth but also at the earth's atmosphere. And it, the topic that generally concerns with hydrology are the water in the streams and lakes, rainfall and snowfall, snow and ice on the land, water occurring below the earth's surface, in the pores of soils and rocks. So these are the four broad topics that hydrology generally concerns itself with. So let me go to the next slide and let me tell you something, that hydrology is a interdisciplinary subject, and it draws support from many broad subjects. I have listed some of them, for example, meteorology, geology, statistics, chemistry, physics, and lastly, fluid mechanics. So these are some of the subjects that hydrology draws support from. There are lots more subjects, but I have listed only few of them. Next, hydrology can be classified into two broad categories. First one will be scientific hydrology. Next is engineering or applied hydrology. So this scientific hydrology is only concerned with the academic aspects. But if I say engineering hydrology or applied hydrology, it generally concerns itself with the engineering applications that we generally study in engineering or in masters or in even in PhD. Next, this engineering hydrology or the applied hydrology that I was talking about, it generally deals with estimation of water resources. For example, what will be the reservoir capacity or what is the discharge of a particular stream or a river. So this type of estimation of water resources, this particular subject deals itself with. Next is, it also does the study of precipitation, various processes, for example, precipitation, runoff, evapotranspiration, and also about their interaction, because all of these processes have a continuous interaction with each other, because without their interaction, these processes won't be able to sustain. Next and lastly, engineering hydrology deals with the problems related to water. For example, floods and droughts. These are the two main broad problems that we deal with that are related to water. So floods and droughts, these are the problems that engineering hydrology deals with. And also, it studies the strategies to combat them. Next topic is hydrologic cycle. So there are some few points before we go into the hydrologic cycle. There are some few points that we need to remember. So for example, it is in many references, if we are going to study in some other references, it will be also mentioned as water cycle. So these are the two same term. Next, water never leaves earth. That we need to remember, water never leaves earth. The next point that we need to remember is, it is constantly being cycled through the atmosphere, ocean, river and land. It is constantly being cycled. This particular point will be discussed in the later slides, because this particular point relates with the hydrologic cycle deeply. Next, this particular water hydrologic cycle or water cycle that I'm talking about, it is very important for the existence of every life on our planet. Next, there are few steps in water cycle. So broadly, there are three steps. First is evapotranspiration. Next is condensation. And lastly, precipitation. These are the three steps that water cycle consists of. And the interaction between them and a continuous flow of water between them is known as water cycle. We'll discuss these points later on. First point was evaporation and transpiration, or the first step that I was talking about was evaporation and transpiration. So evaporation and transpiration generally means the loss of water from land or water bodies. So for example, water present in earth are generally found in two forms, surface water and groundwater. If I am talking about the loss of surface water, then I'm talking about evaporation process. And if I'm talking about the loss of groundwater, then I am trying to say that I am talking about transpiration. And nowadays, these two terms are combined, also known as evapotranspiration. So this is the first step that hydrologic cycles starts with. Next, condensation. So we already know the meaning of condensation, but still, so the process in which water rises in the form of gas higher into the atmosphere, it then generally starts cooling and come back to its original form, that is the liquid form. And this particular process of changing its state from gas to liquid again is known as condensation. So what happens is when a large amount of water vapor condenses, it then generally results in the formation of clouds. And the last step is precipitation. So when the particular water is stored in a cloud becomes very heavy, then the water falls back again to the earth. So these are the three steps the water cycle consists of. First one was evapotranspiration, the second one was condensation, and the last one was precipitation. So let's see in this figure. So if you see on my left hand side, you see a large water body. For example, consider it to be an ocean. So a large amount of water vapor will be released from here because of the presence of sun or solar energy. So this particular evaporated water will go up. It will then condense, form some cloud. And if the cloud becomes too heavy, precipitation will occur. That is the cycle. The sum of maximum part of the water will again fall on the ocean, but some part of that water will go and fall on the land masses because of the presence of wind, because there is always the presence of wind and the transportation of clouds are a continuous process. Next, if I consider an ocean, then this is the process. For example, if I consider a land mass, for example, if I on my right, there is a small water body, consider it to be a lake. So some amount of water will be evaporated from here also. So cloud will be formed here also. Some part of that particular water will fall on this area and some of it will fall on the bigger area, bigger water bodies. And if I consider the transpiration process I already mentioned, I mentioned evapotranspiration. If I consider that portion also, then if you notice there is a plant or a tree, transpiration is occurring here. The plant uptake, this particular arrow only means the water from the ground that this particular plant is taking, and this transpiration is also occurring here in the landmass itself. And this transpiration and evaporation, combinedly known as evapotranspiration, is forming the clouds, and again the precipitation will be occurring. So this is a continuous process. It is never ending process. You cannot pause them, and you cannot start with one and end with other. This is a continuous process. And if I consider areas with highly, for example, glaciers and all, then there a process will be occurring that is known as sublimation. And this sublimation portion process only means that change of state is from solid to gases directly. Other part remains the same. Here also same thing will be happening. Sublimation, water vapor will be going up, it will again condense, and in form of snow or hail or drizzle, it will fall again back to the glacier. So this continuous process is known as water cycle or hydrologic cycle. So this particular process we all need to remember is very important for each and every organism in this planet for its survival. Next, let us go to some aspects of hydrologic cycle. So the paths that I was talking about, if you can see in the figure again, there are paths that I have drawn. So this path, it's a continuous cycle. So the path I was talking about generally involves one, two, or three of these aspects simultaneously. The three aspects are transportation of water, next is temporary storage, and the last one is change of state. So each and every part of the hydrologic cycle generally consists of one or two of these aspects. That is transportation of water, the water is transported, temporary storage, that simply means water will be temporarily stored in the ditches or small potholes or depression in the land masses. Next, the change of state that we have already seen, that water is changing its state continuously from liquid to gas, then again from gas to liquid. Next, let us go to the components of hydrologic cycle and how they can be classified. So broadly, this particular components of hydrologic cycle can be classified into two components. The first part is transportation component, that generally involves precipitation, evaporation, transpiration, infiltration, and runoff. And the next component is storage component, that is storage on the land surface. As I already mentioned, the temporary storage part, there are depression storage, the ponds are there, lakes are there, even reservoirs are there. Next is soil moisture storage, the moisture that is stored in the soil. And lastly, because of the soil moisture storage, a portion of the water goes into the groundwater storage as well. That particular part also comes into the storage component. Next is the water budget equation. But before going into the water budget equation, let us first understand a particular definition, that is catchment area. So simple definition would be the area of land that drains into a water course at a given location. So to understand this, you all can imagine a wash basin, the wash basin that you wash your hands into. So there is an outlet in the bottom, small circular outlet. So in that particular wash basin, wherever you want to throw water, that particular water will indirectly or directly go to that particular outlet. So for that particular outlet, your wash basin is the catchment area. So this particular catchment area, whenever I'm talking about, is always dependent upon a stream or a point where all the water drains. So that is the definition that I'm trying to explain. I hope you all did understood that the area of land that drains into a water course. I already gave you an example of the wash basin. Next, this particular catchment area, in some of the references, you may also find it as drainage area or drainage basin. But in USA, it is primarily known as watershed. Next. So I was talking about the water budget equation. So for any given problem area, for example, any given problem area, say for a catchment, in an interval of time delta T, any interval, I'm talking about any time interval delta T, if I want to write the continuity equation for the water in its various phases, I can simply write mass inflow minus mass outflow should be equal to the change in mass storage. So if I consider the densities of the inflow, outflow, and the storage volumes to be the same, then I can simply write this mass inflow minus mass outflow equal to change in mass storage as Vi minus V naught should be equal to delta S. So this particular Vi is the inflow volume of water into the problem area during the time period. This V naught that I was talking about is the outflow volume of water from the problem area, that we always need to remember, from the problem area during the time period. Whenever I'm saying the inflow volume or outflow volume, I am using a term time period. Always we need to remember a point about water budget equation. This particular equation always depends on a time period or on a time interval in which this particular budget equation will be calculated. And lastly, delta S, that is the change in the storage of the water volume over and under the given area during the given period. So when I say over and under, that I am referring to surface as well as groundwater storage changes. So we need to remember that also, that whenever I am talking about change in storage, I am referring to the point that there will be change in the surface storage as well as the groundwater storage. So next, if I want to simplify this water budget equation, so I can simply write it for any time interval and for any catchment area, I can simply write it as P minus R minus G minus E minus T should be equal to delta S. So this capital P, this particular capital P means precipitation. Capital R is denoting surface runoff. Capital G is the net groundwater flow out of the catchment, that we need to remember. This is the groundwater flow that is getting out of the catchment. E is the evaporation. T is the transpiration. And lastly, delta S is the change in the storage that I was talking about. So if you remember the equation that I already have shown here, that mass inflow minus mass outflow should be equal to the change in mass storage. So what I have written here is precipitation is the only mass inflow in a particular catchment, and rest, whatever the surface runoff is, the net groundwater flow out of the catchment, evaporation, transpiration, these are all mass outflow. So that is why they are only negative sign, and the positive part is only the precipitation part. Next, the storage component that I was talking about, it generally consists of three components. The first is surface water storage. The next is water that is stored in the soil moisture. And the last part is water in storage as groundwater. So these three components, generally, if we combine these three components, we get the term capital S. That was the storage change that I was talking about. Next, one more important relationship that we need to all remember is rainfall runoff relationship. So whenever I'm talking about rainfall runoff relationship, we can simply write it as R equal to P minus L. R means runoff, P means precipitation, and L means losses. Or you can say it as water not available to run off due to losses. So these losses may be of various reasons. For example, infiltration, evaporation, transpiration, or surface storage. The temporary storage that I was talking about, it leads to the losses. Losses simply means the water that is not available to run off. And we all know that runoff will only start after all the losses have already occurred. Next is, let us discuss the statistics of the global freshwater resources that is available on the globe. If you see the topmost figure, I have shown saline water and freshwater together, that is present in the ocean, saline water in present in the ocean and freshwater. So if you can see the percentage, that is 97% of the total water, the freshwater resources that we have in this earth is in the form of saline water, that is in the ocean. And only 3% of the freshwater is available for us. And if I divide this 3%, so you see 68.7% or 69% of it is present in ice caps and glaciers. 30.1% or 31%, you can say it around to be 31%, is present in groundwater. Surface water, if I talk about the percentage, only 0.3% of the water, fresh water, is available in the surface water. And other sources, if I combine them all, it will come to around 1% or 0.9%. And for this surface water, if I want to divide this surface water into various parts, so lakes, if I consider, 87% of the surface water is in the lakes. 11% of that is in wetlands, and 2% of that is in the rivers. So we'll discuss all these things in details in the next slide. So first was glaciers and permanent ice caps. So as I already mentioned, that this form of fresh water accounts for around 69% of the total freshwater resources. around the globe. So they are located in about 10% of the total world landmass. And it is estimated that Greenland and Antarctica accounts for the most of this category of water. Next, I was talking about groundwater. So groundwater represents the second most abundantly available freshwater resources. So it constitutes, I already mentioned, about 30% of the freshwater resources of the globe. If I consider freshwater lakes, so it accounts for around 0.26% of the total freshwater resources, and more than 50% of these lakes are found in Canada. Next, reservoirs. So what exactly reservoir means? So if I talk about reservoir, it simply means artificial lakes created by humans through the construction of dams across rivers. So these are used for various purposes. As you people already know, these are used for agriculture, irrigation, drinking water, hydropower generation, and industrial use also. So these reservoirs are created by humans through the construction of dams. So most of this water in this reservoir, estimated to be in the order of 4,300 kilometer cube. This particular, the amount of water stored in this reservoir are basically used for beneficial purposes. As I already mentioned, for irrigation, drinking water, hydropower generation, and also industrial use. Next is wetlands. So a part of the freshwater resource that I was talking about, around 0.04%, is distributed in the globe as wetland. Or marshes or lagoons or swamps. So this particular water body plays a very important role in maintaining the freshwater ecology. We all need to remember that, because it also helps in the recharge of groundwater. So this is the very important part about wetlands, that it recharges groundwater, which is getting depleted day by day now. Next and the last part is rivers in the freshwater part. So we all know the rivers are one of the most important part of freshwater resource. Even though if I say about the percentage, or if we look at the statistics, it is only around 0.006% of freshwater resource. But even then, it forms the core of human activity related to natural water resources. A substantial part of subject of engineering hydrology deals with the river flow. Whenever I'm talking about engineering hydrology or applied hydrology, a very important part or a very huge part of it only deals with the river flow. And when I'm saying river flow, it also includes river stages, river discharge, river meandering. These all parts come into engineering hydrology, and it's a huge topic in hydrology. Next, let us talk something about history of hydrology. So firstly, we all know water is the prime requirement for the existence of each and every life in our planet. Next, history has instances of civilizations that flourished within the availability of dependable water supplies and then collapsed when the water supply failed. So there are numerous references also that exist in Vedic literature to groundwater availability and its utility. And around 3000 BC, groundwater development through wells was known to people of the Indus Valley civilizations also, and it was revealed by archaeological excavations at Mohenjo-Daro. Next, there are many quotations in ancient Hindu scriptures that indicate the existence of knowledge of hydrologic cycle, even as far as back to the Vedic period. We all know this particular hydrologic cycle that I was talking about now. In Hindu scriptures, there are many quotations that already indicate that these particular points were known by the civilization much more earlier than we know now. Then the first description of the rain gauge. When I'm saying rain gauge, a rain gauge is an instrument that is used to measure precipitation. So the first description of this particular instrument was contained in an Arthashastra by Chanakya. Even Egyptians knew the importance of stage measurement of rivers. When I'm saying stage measurement of rivers, I'm meaning that the height of the river from its bed. So Egyptians knew the importance of that measurement and record the stages of the Nile river dating back to the 1800 BC, and these particular data have been located. And the knowledge of hydrologic cycle came to be known in the Europe much later, around AD 1500. Next, if I try to classify the history of hydrology, so a scientist named Chow classified history of hydrology into 8 different periods. So the first was, he said that 8 different periods can be used to classify the entire history of hydrology. So the first, he said, the first period is period of speculation. So he said it should be around the prior to AD 1400. Next, the period of observation. He said that it should be around 1400 to 1600. Next, period of measurement, 1600 to 1700. Next, period of experimentation, 1700 to 1800, followed by period of modernization, 1800 to 1900, and period of empiricism, 1900 to 1930. Next, period of rationalization, 1930 to 1950, and lastly, period of theoretization, that is 1950 to till date. Next, most of the present-day science of the hydrology has been developed since 1930. So thus, in some of the references, you may also find that hydrology has given the status of young science. There's the worldwide activities also in water resource developments in the last few decades by both developed and developing countries, aided by the rapid advances in the instrumentation for data acquisition and in the computer facilities for data analysis, have contributed a lot towards the rapid growth of this young science. Next, what are the applications of hydrology in engineering? Because as I was already mentioning again and again that I'm talking about applications of hydrology in engineering. So first application would be irrigation. We all know what irrigation means. Next is water supply. Next is flood control. Next, water power. And lastly, navigation. These are the five broad applications of hydrology in engineering. So these all has their subparts. They all have their own problems and their own lots of problems in between them. Next, as I mentioned, the above five projects, hydrological investigation for the proper assessment of the following factors are necessary. For the above mentioned projects, for example, if I say irrigation also, so the capacity of storage structures such as reservoirs. This needs to be properly assessed before even going to for the construction of a storage structure, for example, a dam. So we need to first calculate the capacity of that particular reservoir. Next, the magnitude of the flood flows to enable the safe disposal of the excess flow. So we need to calculate the maximum amount of highest flood level, or you can say the highest flood level, to just make sure to enable the safe disposal of the excess water. Next, the minimum flow and the quantity of flow available at various seasons. So the minimum also we need to calculate or assess, and the quantity of flow in various seasons, we also need to assess that. Next, the interaction of flood wave and hydraulic structures, such as reservoirs, barrages, and bridges. So we also need to assess the interaction of the flood wave and also flood wave with the hydraulic structure. And examples are given: reservoirs, barrages, and bridges. So there are many important projects. Those have already failed because of the improper assessment of those hydrological factors that we just read. So some of the typical kind of failures in hydraulic structures, or you can say this type of failures, you can mention it by using a term that is hydraulic failures. So the first one is overtopping and consequent failure of an earthen dam. So overtopping means nothing. If the water flow or the highest flood level goes over the dam, then it is known as overtopping. Next is failure of bridges and culverts due to excess flood flow. If there is an excess flood flow, the bridges will fail as well as the culverts also. And lastly, inability of a large reservoir to fill up with water due to overestimation of the stream flow. In many of cases, this is also observed that the quantity that the reservoir was, obviously a calculation is made before constructing a huge reservoir. But if the calculation is overestimated in terms of, if I am considering a small stream and I am considering it to fill up a large dam, So that is an overestimation part. So if that is overestimated, then the reserver, the construction part, it is not feasible because of the economic consideration. So these are some type of failures that generally also known as hydraulic failures. Next, what are the sources of data that are generally required for hydrologists to do all this type of calculations? So there are many data, for example, weather records such as temperature, humidity, wind velocity. There are precipitation data that is required for the hydrologist to calculate all these things. Next is stream flow records. Next, evaporation and evapotranspiration data. Next, infiltration characteristics of the study area. Next, what are the types of soils in the area or the soils of the area? Next, what is the land use and the land cover of that particular area? Next, what are the groundwater characteristics of that particular area? Then physical and geological characteristics of the area. And lastly, water quality of the at that particular area or water quality data. So these data, if I talk about India, so many of these data you can find in IMD, that is Indian Meteorological Department. If I require some ground data, then I need to go to CGWB, that is Central Groundwater Board. And if I need some general data, then Central Water Commission, CWC, is also there. So these are some of the organizations from where you can get the data, or the hydrologists get their data to do all the calculations to make the necessary assessment of the things that we already discussed. Mr. Jay, sir, if you can now give the poll.
Yes, I will do that. So you have two polls. So the first one, what is the percentage? That one, no?
Yes, sir.
So I have launched a poll, and I request all of you to vote. Once again, I will wait for a minute. So around 20 seconds, we have got around 32% votes. I will wait for 1 minute. I request all of you to kindly vote at your earliest. Okay, so we have almost reached 50 seconds, 50% votes we have reached. I'm waiting for maybe 5 more seconds, 56 seconds already. So, okay, so it's around 51% votes today. I'm closing it and sharing the results. So I'm sure you can see the results, where 24% people goes for less than 90%. 35% people goes for 68.7%. 17% people goes for 87%, and 24% people goes for 97%, which means the voting today is what should I say, almost equal in all the figures. Very close, not equal, very close. You can take over.
Yes, sir. So
Dr. Das, yes,
the answer should be the last one, that is 97%, as we already discussed. So less than 90%, 24% is okay, but 68.7 and 87%, I don't know. The correct answer should be 97%. 97% of water, total water on Earth, is in the saline form.
Okay, so you can continue again.
Yes, sir. Okay, next. Since this is only the introduction part of the water resources engineering, so I will go for the precipitation part only, because it will take much more time to consider all the different processes. So for today, only precipitation part we are going to consider. So first of all, let us define what precipitation means. So simple definition is all forms of water that reach the earth from the atmosphere. All forms of water, and for precipitation to form, there are some favorable conditions that should be there. First of all, there should be presence of moisture in the atmosphere. Next, there must be a sufficient nuclei present for condensation. That means to aid condensation, there must be sufficient nuclei present. Next, weather conditions must be good for condensation. And lastly, the product of condensation must fall on Earth's surface. Next, there are various forms of precipitation. First is rain, as you have already, we all know about rain. This is the principal form of precipitation in India. But technically, when I want to define rain, I simply mean form of water drops of sizes larger than 0.5 mm and the larger than 0.5 mm, that I need to remember always. If the sizes of the water droplets are larger than 0.5 mm, then I will be considering that particular form of precipitation as rain. And the maximum size of a raindrop is 6 mm, that we need to remember. But there are various types of rain, as you can see in this particular table. There are various types of rain, light rain, moderate rain, and heavy rain. These are all classified based on the intensity of it. So when I say light rain, I mean trace to 2.5 millimeter per hour. And when I say moderate rain, I'm trying to say that the intensity of that particular rainfall is 2.5 mm per hour to 7.5 mm per hour. And when I say heavy rain, that simply means if the intensity is greater than 7.5 millimeter per hour, then I'm trying to say that it is a heavy rain. Next form of precipitation is snow. So snow basically consists of ice crystals, which usually combine to form flakes, obviously when fresh. And when fresh, this snow has an initial density that varies from 0.06 to 0.15 gram per centimeter cube. But it is usual to assume that it has an average density of 0.1 gram per centimeter cube. Next form of precipitation is drizzle. So drizzle simply means a fine sprinkle of numerous water droplets of size less than 0.5 mm. That is the basic difference between rain and drizzle. If the size of the water droplet is more than 0.5 mm, then I will be considering it as rain. And if the size of the water droplet is less than 0.5 mm, and the intensity as well as is less than 1 millimeter per hour, then I will be considering it as drizzle. Next is glaze. So when I say glaze, I simply mean whenever rain or drizzle comes in contact with cold ground. When I say cold ground, I'm trying to say that it should be around at 0 degrees Celsius. Then those particular water drops freeze to form an ice coating. So that particular ice coating is known as glaze, and this particular form of precipitation is called glaze. And last part is hail. This is the last form of precipitation in India. It basically means showery precipitation in the form of irregular pellets or lumps of ice, the size of which should be more than 8 millimeter. We need to remember this particular value because that is the difference between hail and snow. So the size should be more than 8 mm. Next, how would you measure precipitation? Or right now I'm considering rainfall because this is the prime form of precipitation in India. So I will be considering rainfall only. So precipitation in general is expressed in terms of depth to which rainfall water would stand on an area if all the rain were collected on it. So you have all of us watch news and also we see that this much mm of rainfall has happened in this particular area. So when they say that they only mean that this much mm of water, if all the rainfall were collected, that was happening in that particular area, if all the rainfall were collected, then whatever the height of that particular water would be, that is the amount of rainfall that is occurring. That is the meaning of the unit. That is when I already mentioned that precipitation is generally expressed in terms of depth. So precipitation is collected and measured in rain gauge. So this is the instrument that we generally use to measure precipitation. And in some of the references, you may find it as pluviometer, ombrometer, or hydrometer. These are the terms that are not common, but some of the references use them to designate rain gods. So if I say what exactly is a rain god, then I simply want to say that it is a cylindrical vessel assembly kept in the open to collect rain, nothing else. Simply a cylindrical vessel assembly that is kept in the open to collect rain. Next, if I want to set up a rain gauge, there are some considerations that I need to keep in my mind. The first part is the ground must be level and in the open. The next is the instrument must present a horizontal catch surface. That means the catch surface or whatever the area that it is collecting, it should present a horizontal surface. The next is the gauge must be set as near as the ground as possible to reduce the wind effect. But it must be sufficiently high also to prevent the splashing or flooding, because we don't want our rain gauge to be influenced by splashing and flooding. Next point is the instrument must be surrounded by an open fenced area of at least 5.5 meter into 5.5 meter. Next, no object should be nearer to the instrument than 30 meter or twice the height of the obstruction. So these are the 5 points that we need to keep in mind before setting up the rain gauge. So there are two types of rain gauge. First is non-recording and the next is recording. So when I say non-recording, that I am trying to say that this type of gauges cannot record the data on their own. They need a different instrument to record the data. They can only collect the rainwater, they cannot record it. And the next, if I say a recording type of rain gauge, then I'm trying to say that it can collect as well as record the data simultaneously. And some of the rain gauges now that have been developed can even plot the rainfall intensity with respect to the time. We are not going to go into the details of the rain gauge because there are various types of rain gauge and it will take a lot of time to cover all those. But let me go to the topic, that is rain gauge network. So this is also an important part that we need to understand, because first of all, let us discuss something about network density. As I already mentioned about the catchment area, so the catchment area of a particular rain gauge is very small as compared to the total aerial extent of the storm. Because I said it is a rain gauge is a cylindrical vessel assembly. So the catching area of that particular rain gauge, if I compare it with the aerial extent of the storm or the area extent of the storm, it is very less. So to get a representative picture of that particular storm over a catchment, so what I need to do is I need to set up a large number of rain gauges so that the catchment area per gauge should be small. If you want to say it in some other way, so the number of rain gauges should be as large as possible just to be sure that the catching area of the rain gauge is somewhat similar to the area extent of the storm. But there are problems also, for example, economic considerations. So economic consideration to a large extent and other considerations such as topography, accessibility. So these are the points that restricts the number of gauges to be maintained. So what we do is, as a hydrologist, what we do is we try to aim at the optimum density of gauges from which reasonably accurate information about the storms can be obtained. It is obvious that we cannot get the actual reading. There would be some error, but at least a reasonable accurate information should be there. Next, there are densities. The World Meteorological Organization have already recommended us. So they recommended that in flat regions of temperate, Mediterranean and tropical zones, ideally one station for 600 to 900 kilometer square is okay. And if the acceptable part, if I'm talking, then one station for 900 to 3000 kilometer square, it is acceptable. And if it is in the mountainous region of temperate, Mediterranean and tropical zones, ideally one station for 100 to 250 kilometer is okay. And if I talk about the acceptable part, then one station for 25 to 1000 kilometer square is acceptable. And in arid and polar regions, one station for 1500 to 10,000 kilometer square is acceptable. Next, these are the previous recommendations were from WMO, but From practical consideration of Indian conditions, the IS code, the Indian standard code, IS 4987 1968, has recommended us for the following densities as sufficient. They have recommended that in plains, one station per 150 km square is okay. In regions of average elevation of 1000 meter, one station per 260 to 390 km square is okay. In predominantly hilly areas with heavy rainfall, one station per 130 km square is okay. Next, preparation of data. Say we have learned about setting up the rain gauge, what are the points that you need to keep in mind, what are the types of rain gauges. Next, how is the data prepared before it is actually used? So the first point that you need to keep in mind is, before using the rainfall data in application, it is necessary to first check the data for continuity and consistency. So the continuity of data may be broken with the missing data due to many reasons. For example, a damage or fault in the rain gauge during the measuring period. So these are the points that we also need to check before using that data for any calculation. So if I want to check the consistency of record, so when I say that consistency of the of a particular record or data is changing, I'm trying to say that the conditions relevant to the recording of the rain gauge stations have undergone a significant change. When? During the period of record, and inconsistently will arise in the rainfall data of that particular station. So some of the common causes for this inconsistency are shifting of the rain gauge to a new location, the neighborhood of the station undergoing a mark change, change in the ecosystem due to calamities such as forest fires, landslides, and occurrence of observational error from a certain date. So this checking of inconsistency is done by a method known as double mask curve method. So this technique is based on the principle that each recorded data, when it comes from the same parent population, they are consistent. Next, if you look into the figure, this is an explanation of the double mask curve that I was talking to check the consistency of any record. So in the x-axis, if you see, I have accumulated annual rainfall of 10 station mean. So what I need is, I need accumulated annual rainfall of 5 to 10 neighboring stations. Neighboring station, when I'm saying neighboring stations, I mean, if I am supposed to be checking the consistency of data at a station X, so I need 5 to 10 stations data around it, the neighboring data. So in the y-axis, we have accumulated annual rainfall at X, the particular station where I need to check whether the data is consistent or not. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to plot these two data in reverse chronological order. That means latest data first. So I will be plotting these data. So if you see, this should follow a trend somewhat like this. A straight line it should follow. But what it did was, it changed its slope from the year 63. This 63, 62, these are years, okay? 1963, 1962. So it changes its slope from here. So we knew that this particular year was the year where the data become inconsistent for the data or for to be used by the hydrologist. So what we did was, we draw a line that was following the trend. And then the original one is also plotted. So what we need to do is, we need to find the correction ratio from this particular curve, that is MC by MA or C by A. After finding this correction ratio, suppose I need to find the corrected data at the station X at, if I look into the figure, so 1963, from 1963, it is inconsistent. So if I want to find the precipitation at 1963, I need to simply multiply it by the precipitation recorded in the year 1963 with the correction ratio that I calculated using the curve. So PCX that I have mentioned here is the corrected precipitation at any time period at station X. PX is the original recorded precipitation at time period at station X. MC is the corrected slope of the double mass curve, and MA is the original slope of the double mass curve. Next is presentation of rainfall data. So we already get to know how we collected the data, how we checked for the consistency part. Now, how would you present the rainfall data? So the first way is to present the rainfall data using a mask curve. So what marks of it? It is a plot of accumulated precipitation against time, plotted in chronological order. Next is records of flow type and weighing bucket type gauges are generally in this type of form. So the mass curve are generally used to determine the information such as duration and magnitude of the storm. So if you look into the figure, this is a mass curve. So I said y-axis would be accumulated precipitation and the x-axis would be the time duration. So if you see the first time, the first storm duration, I have mentioned it here, the first storm stops here because the line is getting more or less parallel to the x-axis. So that is when I know the storm has stopped. And what is the accumulated precipitation at this point? 10 centimeters. So this is the, so we get to know from this curve that the duration and magnitude of the storm. And whenever this particular curve is again rising, then we get to know the second storm has started again. So then we can also calculate the duration of the second storm and the magnitude of the second storm. Next way to represent rainfall data is hydrograph. So it is basically a plot of intensity of rainfall against time interval. It is basically derived from the mass curve itself and is usually represented as bar, as a bar chart. It is a very convenient way of representing the characteristics of a storm, and it is very important in the development of designs of storms to predict extreme flood. So this is a figure of an hydrograph. The x-axis is rainfall intensity and y-axis, x-axis is time duration and y-axis is rainfall intensity. Next topic is point rainfall. So till now, whatever we have discussed is station rainfall only. So when I say station rainfall on point rainfall, I want to say that it simply means the rainfall data of a particular station, not for a particular area. So depending upon the need, this particular data can be listed as daily, weekly, monthly, seasonal, or annual. So these data are represented generally as plots of magnitude versus time in the form of bar diagram. So as mentioned earlier, till now whatever we have learned is point rainfall data. That means data for a particular station. It is not the data for entire area. So rain gauges only represent only point sampling of the aerial distribution of the storm. But in practice, if you notice, hydrological analysis requires a knowledge of rainfall over an area, such as over a catchment. So what we need to do is, we need to convert this point rainfall data into average value over that particular catchment. So there are various methods. Today I'll be only discussing this particular three methods. So those are arithmetical mean method, Thiessen polygon method, and isohyetal method. So first method is arithmetical mean method. So whenever the rainfall measured at various stations in a catchment show very little variation in the average precipitation over a particular catchment, then a simpler arithmetic mean can be used. So suppose, for example, P1, P2, P3, Pi till Pn are the rainfall values in a given period in any station, then the mean precipitation over that catchment area can simply be calculated using arithmetical mean. But we need to remember that the station, the recorded data should show very little variation. Next is Thiessen mean method. So if you look into this figure, you can see this particular 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. These are the rain gauge stations. So, and this is the catchment area. This particular irregular figure is the catchment area. So in this particular method, first of all, what we need to do is we need to join all the rain gauge stations for using sets of triangles. So what I did was I simply joined all these stations using various triangles. Next, what I need to do is I need to draw perpendicular bisectors of each and every site. So when I draw particular perpendicular bisectors of each and every site, what I see is each and every station, each and every rain gauge station is surrounded by a polygon. And these polygons are known as Thiessen polygon. So for example, if I consider rain gauge at station 1, it is bounded by a polygon A, B, C, D. So if I want to give it an area, suppose A1, and this method is based that not only the data I mean, rain gauge data inside the catchment is used. It is also superior than the arithmetical mean method because it is also using the data from outside the catchment. So that's why it is superior method than arithmetical mean method. Next, when I do this, what I need to find is the area of the this particular Thiessen polygon. So for each and every station, there are Thiessen polygons. What we need to do is we need to find the area of this Thiessen polygon. Next, when I calculate the Thiessen area, Thiessen polygon area, we can use the simple formula as written here to calculate the average precipitation over that particular station. And the last method is isohyetal method. So an isohyet is a line joining the points of equal rainfall magnitude. So when I say isohyet, I simply means that it is a line that joins the points of equal rainfall. So in the isohyetal method, the catchment area is drawn to a scale. First of all, the catchment area will be drawn in a scale and the rain gauge stations will be marked. Then the recorded values for which area average mean precipitation is to determine are then marked on the plot at appropriate station. Next, what we are going to do is neighboring stations outside the catchments are also considered. So this method and Thiessen polygon method, the advantage of these two methods are that they don't only use the data from the catchment area, they use the data from outside the catchment also. Next, the isohyets are drawn by considering point rainfall as guide and interpolating them by the eye. So the area between the two isohyets are determined using a planimeter. So if you look into the figure, this particular lines that I have drawn is isohyets or isohyetals, you can say. And this A, B, C, D, these are the stations or the rain gauge stations. So we need to find the area between these isohyets, the inter-isohyetal area. So when I find the inter-isohyetal area, what we need to do is we can use directly this formula to get the mean precipitation over the area. So this is all from my side. Vishwajit sir, if you can give the poll now.
So you have your second poll. I will just very quickly shoot the second poll. I request all members to quickly vote. I have launched it. So hydrology can be classified into how many periods? 5 or 6 or 7 or 8? So that's the question. I request all members to vote quickly. We have reached roughly 30% votes. We are waiting for 1 minute as always. Out of that, 30 seconds have passed. So I request all other members to vote within the coming maybe 25 seconds. We have reached roughly 45% votes. 15 more seconds left. All members, please vote quickly. We are only left with the last 5 seconds. Okay, so it's 1 minute over. We have again received 50% votes. I close it and I will share the results. So it's 39% saying 5, 44% saying 6, 11% 7, and 7% 8.
The correct answer should be the last one, that is 8. As I already mentioned, that the hydrology.
That is 8, yes.
Yes, sir. That is and the correct. That is
only 7% people have voted for that. So I think people did not follow you that. Okay. Yes. So I request all members to kindly follow whatever is being said. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Dash. Do you have any more slides to present?
No, sir. No, sir.
Okay. So I can share one or two questions with you very quickly. Maybe you can take one question or two questions.
Yes, sir.
So Dr. Shubhrata Chattopadhyay has a question. Can water resource engineering be used to save greenhouse effect?
Save greenhouse effect?
Yes.
So directly there is no connection, but yes, studies are going on. But directly no, but studies, yes, there's still a lot of studies are going on to be sure that this greenhouse effect and water resource engineering can be connected somehow.
Right. So there's a question from Pinaki Mukherjee. What kind of effective steps can be taken for flood control in coastal areas?
Effective control, now effective control, a lot of ways are there. For example, there construction part, as far as the construction part goes, if you can go to the beaches in India also, you can see a lot of stones and all that have been thrown there, just to be sure that the flood, the waves can not directly hit the area. So these are some of the parts. There are lots of ways. Even boulders are used nowadays just to tie things up, to be sure that the wave, when it hits the shore, it does not hit that hard and does not destroy any property. So these are some of the ways, although there are lots of ways. It's a separate topic, sir.
Okay. So one question from Dr. Shubhrata Chattopadhyay. Why West Bengal is, okay, this is a little bit of a controversial question, I believe, but still, let me read it out. Why West Bengal is at the mercy of cyclones, whereas Orisha has been able to control? How can West Bengal overcome by water resources engineering? The data, I don't know whether there is any data like that.
Yes, Dr. Das, is there any data like that? No, sir, I don't have any data, sir.
Okay. Okay, so maybe we can take that question one to one. Okay,
yes, sir, yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Das. Thanks to all IEM and EM family members. It was a nice presentation. Obhijit Kaur Gupta has proudly written that I have given all correct answers. Okay, so congratulations, Mr. Obhijit Kaur Gupta. Thank you. Thanks to all IEM and EM family members.
Thanks to all.
Thank you.